Our next question comes to us from Nikki, and it's a little bit lengthy, so bear with me while I read it out.
No worries.
She says, I'm someone who, others tell me, lacks emotional expression. I assume the average person feels and shows their emotion. Now I imagine a simplified emotional spectrum.
Can I say firstly that the average person doesn't feel and show their emotion?
No.
And perhaps more than she does. I've met Nikki. So, and I find many people who have an Asian background, which Nikki does have been heavily suppressed emotionally during their childhood.
Yeah.
And so they do find emotional expression difficult. But don't assume that everybody finds it easy and you find it difficult. The reality is pretty much everyone on the planet finds it difficult to express true emotion.
Okay. Yeah. Well, she's got, she's imagining an emotional spectrum.
Yeah.
So there's her, the average person, the very emotional, and the goal, whatever that is.
Whatever that is, and that's indeterminate, I gather.
Yeah, she's not quite sure what that is at the moment.
Sure.
And she gives an example. I know at least one person who is more emotional than the average person. She easily and quite frequently cries.
Whoa, see, this is where it goes off board, doesn't it? But keep going. I suppose
and
it's
this
best
is
if
where
we
this,
read the whole
this
question
is where
and
the
then
spectrum,
we'll go over it.
Is not quite accurate, is it?
Yeah, so, that's right. So let's read the whole question and then we'll go back to each point and I'll make comments about each point,
sure.
I think.
Okay. So this is this person that Nikki knows. She easily and quite frequently cries.
Mm-hmm.
Her husband gives her much to cry about because he is not very active in life, compulsively spends what little they have, plus he has a drug addiction.
Right.
Despite her crying for many years, things did not change much.
Mm.
Well, finally, just this year, he is making an attempt to quit and to change.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder, shouldn't her life have changed already since she has been feeling her emotions? Or is that it? Am I to be like her or is it not? Being someone who lacks emotional expression and observing others who freely show their emotions, I just get confused.
Mm-hmm.
Because even though they are emotional, that's still not it.
No.
Not the goal. Is it because she's, so again, back to her friend, is it because she's still resisting anger and childlike emotions? Is it because she has demands and expectations? Is she somehow addicted to that side of him?
Mm-hmm.
I think my main question is, what does 100% emotional being look like?
Mm-hmm.
What's it like to be in their company and to observe them?
Right. Well, let's answer that part of the question first. My suggestion to Nikki is have a look at the recent talks that we did that were done in 2014 called Understanding Your Emotional Self. There's four of them we've done in a series. And the reason why I recommend to you that you have a look at those four particular videos, which will be in the end probably about 12 hours of viewing, sorry about that, is because you will start to understand what it's going to look like to be your true emotional self.
Yeah.
And so those presentations answer the questions about what it looks like to be your true emotional self. So I don't think we need to say much more on that subject.
No.
Because, you know, the best thing for people to do is to go to those particular videos, which were seminars done with a small group of people in New South Wales in Australia. And the topic was relationship with God, understanding your emotional self. And there's four sessions.
So if we go back to Nikki's story then.
Yes. So let's look at the story because there are comments we need to make about the story.
Yeah. And really she's asking a kind of a question from someone who's not feeling very much emotion herself.
Mm-hmm.
She's observing people being emotional and then saying, isn't that what I'm supposed to do? And this is the problem when we're not very sensitive to our own emotions, isn't it, that we have problems interpreting.
Yes. Firstly, we need to make comments about why we're not sensitive to our own emotion. And that is because we're either in complete denial of our own emotion or we're terrified of feeling our emotions. Now, most people who are in complete denial or terrified of feeling their emotions have had a very difficult childhood emotionally. What that means is that they were taught at a very, very young age to not feel their emotions. And so it does take a fair bit of time and self-reflection and self-analysis to be able to start allowing yourself to feel what you really feel. Mm-hmm. And that's going to take, it's like a softening of your soul, I suppose you could call that. And that's going to also take looking at the issues of suppression, which is what we discuss with how the human soul functions, looking at the areas of resistance and suppression, and also all of the rules, if you like, of how the soul functions. Because you need to understand that you're not going to be able to absorb new things into your soul from an emotional perspective unless some of the old things leave you. Mm. And if one of those old things happens to be your belief about emotions, then, of course, that's one of the first things you're going to have to address.
Yeah.
So I would recommend firstly for such a person to look much more sincerely at how the soul functions. And to, rather than seeing it as I'm not an emotional person, you are an emotional person, understanding that every single person has been created to be emotional being by God. And if we're not, then it's because there is damage that's been done to our soul. And instead of saying I am an emotional, not an emotional person, which is basically saying I am that unemotional being, mm-hmm. you're really better off saying, I am a person who has been damaged quite a lot and I don't feel my emotions well as a result.
Yeah.
So in other words, you start to see not being as an emotional person as damage rather than seeing it as a part of your nature or personality, because it's not a part of your true nature and personality. Mm. It's a part of the hurt person that's inside of you and not a part of the real person who's inside of you. Does that make sense? So that's the first thing you need to come to terms with.
Would you like me to read back through the question?
So let's go back over now. So we've answered that question as to you know, the general comments about, you know, saying I am an emotional person and that person's not an emotional person, or there's so-called emotional spectrums.
I don't
agree with any of those things, because all of us, and I, you know, I've lived in the celestial kingdom, so I know that every single person who's in the celestial spheres is an emotional being. Mm. and it doesn't look like her friend crying all the time, by the way. So we need to define what it looks like.
Can we talk about...
I feel we define that a lot in understanding, in the sessions, understanding your emotional self. So rather than regurgitating all of that information, I think we need to look at her specific situation and make comments about it.
All right. Yeah. So she says, one person she knows is more emotional than the average person.
Mm-hmm.
She easily and quite frequently cries.
Mm-hmm.
Her husband gives her much to cry about because he is just not very active in life, compulsively spends what little they have, plus he has a drug addiction.
And it's very interesting here, you see. See, Nikki is seeing it as if her husband is the problem. This woman, her friend, her husband is the problem. It's not the problem. The problem is this woman has no self-love at all.
Mm.
And when she's crying, she's not crying any causal emotion. What she's doing is she's having a tantrum about somebody else, her husband, not loving her and causing her trouble.
Mm-hmm.
But she doesn't want to leave this man. She doesn't want to have to love herself. So what she's doing in this relationship, this woman, is she's hanging around in a relationship where she doesn't have to love herself, she doesn't want to love herself, and she wants this man to love her. She wants this man to do all of her work for her, basically, emotionally.
Mm-hmm.
She wants this man to provide all of her emotional needs. Now, of course, she's attracted a man under these circumstances. You will attract a man who doesn't do that, who spends all your money and doesn't make you feel safe and secure financially, and who, you know, abuses alcohol or drugs or something else, and that makes you feel like the alcohol or the drugs is the most important thing in his life and not you, and a lot of other reasons for, and then of course this person, the woman, starts crying about all of these things, and all of her crying is just having a tantrum about the fact she's not getting what she wants.
Mm-hmm.
Now that is not processing causal emotion. She's not even processing her anger about how she feels, and she certainly doesn't want to love herself.
Mm-hmm.
If she wanted to love herself, she wouldn't for one moment more put up with that situation.
Mm-hmm.
She would say to the man, look, I love you, but I also must love myself in this circumstance or situation, and that requires that I leave you for a while you sort yourself out and while you get rid of your drug or alcohol or whatever other abusive issue he has towards himself, and while you take more self-responsibility in your life. And I will need to work through all of my addictions as to why I haven't done this 20 years ago.
Yeah.
What caused me to stay in this relationship for such a long time, or 10 years or however long it is, what caused me to stay in this relationship for such a long time while it's abusive towards myself? Yeah. Now, this woman does not want to become more loving. She wants her husband to become more loving, and she doesn't want to have to change herself. She doesn't want her life to change without her husband doing all the work, right? That's not the way it's going to work on the divine truth path. Mm-hmm. That's not the way. Mm-hmm. So this woman may be crying, but she is not working through any causal emotion from her childhood.
And this is where seeing tears as emotional processing we can really go wrong there, can't we?
Totally, yes, because tears aren't emotional processing. A lot of people I see in tears are really in rages. Mm-hmm. And this woman's in a rage, actually. Mm-hmm. She's using tears. She learnt to use tears in her childhood as an emotionally abusive technique to manipulate somebody into doing what she wants. And it's not working. Good. It shouldn't work. And it's not working. But she then is saying that it's really all her husband's fault. No, she's got a lot of issues to work through about her love of self. She's got a lot of growing to do about, you know, how she's not loving herself. She's also not loving her husband because she's putting up with this kind of treatment over and over again. And a person who truly values the truth and values love would not do so. Mm-hmm. So she's not loving her husband and she's not honouring anything. In fact, she's not honouring her children, herself or her husband in this situation. She is teaching her children that they should put up with abusive situations, that they should, you know, put up with abusive like somebody who abuses. I don't mean he's abusive to them. Mm-hmm. And he may or may not be, but he's definitely abusive to himself. And you wouldn't put up with that. Mm. Like if you really love someone, you'd go, no, I don't want you to abuse yourself. You work out why you want to abuse yourself, I'm going to go away from you while you do that. Or I'll help you to work your way through it if you're willing, but I'm not going to put up with this anymore. That's what you would do if you love yourself. And this woman doesn't want to do that. No. So real growth has to be growth in love and truth. Yeah. And this woman is not growing in love and truth. She's feeling some emotions, but none of them are related to her own childhood and her own upbringing, which has obviously caused her to accept this kind of treatment from her husband. And she has no desire to address her internal problems. And as a result, she cries about her husband all the time. Yep. And it's interesting that the observer, Nikki in this case, doesn't see that, which indicates that Nikki herself probably has the same kind of tolerances to abusive behaviour from other people.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So that's an important point that you just made, that often when we have a similar injury, we find it difficult to see in
what's really going on.
The error in it when it's in another, right?
Yeah. And the error in this lady that Nikki's describing is the fact that she doesn't want to love herself.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't want to,
mm-hmm.
right? And lots of people don't want to love themselves for all sorts of reasons. Some people believe that if they love themselves, then it lets everybody else off the hook, which it does, actually.
Yeah.
That's what love does, lets everybody off the hook. But they don't like that idea, you know. They get angry about that idea, so they don't want to do that. Or they feel like people should love them. They demand love or so forth. Now, of course, love demanded isn't love anyway. Love is always a gift. So, you know, there's a misunderstanding about love in that. So there's a lot of misunderstandings about love that would cause a person to cry about their husband's abusive behaviour.
So I don't know quite how to put this into words, so
sure.
And even into a question, but I'll do my best. What I have noticed is that whenever there is a release of causal emotion,
mm-hmm.
so tears, mm-hmm. and if we use, because Nikki's talking about tears, whenever, and usually causal emotion is released via tears.
Well, not necessarily, no.
If it's fear, then it might not be.
If it's fear, you'll be shaking, terrified perhaps. If it's shame, you'll be hot flushes and allowing yourself to feel that. You know, it just depends on the emotion as to what it is. Yeah.
Okay, but usually, because you were talking about the misunderstandings of love that this lady has.
Mm-hmm. Which all were created in her childhood.
Yep.
So she needs to go back to her inner child, if you could use that expression. Or you could say, and more correctly say, she needs to go back into her damaged child.
Yes.
Which is the hurt child that's within the second of the three selves.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the three selves, there's the real self, the hurt self, the facade self. Yep. This woman's in her facade self.
Yeah.
She's not, and all of the processing she's doing in that place doesn't mean a single thing. She can go on like doing that for the next 50 years.
Can we even call it processing?
No, it's not processing because processing is all about feeling the hurt self.
So, yeah, and this
or feeling the reasons why you constructed your facade self.
Okay.
Yeah. Which are all based on the hurt.
Yeah.
Go on, but you
were going to say. My observation is that there's always truth in that in causal processing.
Always, but it's also always childhood.
Yep.
Or repentance. It's only those two things.
Yep.
In this case, the lady needs to repent for the way she's treating herself. And she obviously is treating herself this way because of something that occurred in her childhood that made her have a predisposition towards treating herself this way.
Yeah. So there's always an element of truth of what happened in our childhood or truth in the way that we've harmed another when we are releasing a causal emotion.
Always. Yep.
So this lady is not connected with truth on either level.
No, no truth about love at all, no truth about herself, no truth about her husband. He doesn't care. He loves drink more or drugs more than he loves her.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no truth about that, you know.
And she's not also being truthful about the way that she's attempting to manipulate him.
That's right. She's emotionally manipulating him. Yep. She's using a technique that many women use because they, when they get angry with a man who's abusing substances, the man gets angry in return and probably becomes physically violent. So they don't want that. So what they do is they use tears as a way of emotionally manipulating the man to change his behaviour.
Yeah.
But that's a learned response from her own childhood, you know. But it is manipulative and it's out of harmony with love. It's where she's not being loving to him.
Yeah.
You don't manipulate a person when you want their behaviour to change. You just say, I need your behaviour to change because it's this and that and this and that, which is all unloving. And if you don't do that, I'm just saying, I'm going to leave you until you do that.
Yeah.
You wouldn't even say if you do that or don't do that. You just go, I'm going to leave you until you do that.
Yeah.
And when you're ready, when you think you've done that, give me a call because I still love you.
Yeah.
You know, I still care about you, I still love you, I still want to be with you. I just can't put up with that behaviour.
Yeah. Okay, so then if we go back to Nikki's start of the question where she's imagining a spectrum where she's on one end, the average person.
So I suppose she's saying, like, shut down, shut down.
Totally shut down, she's saying. The average person.
Yeah.
The very emotional and the goal.
Mm-hmm.
And she's saying her friend is in this very emotional category.
Yeah, I don't feel so.
Which is further along the spectrum than Nikki. But is that really a fair statement?
No, not at all. Her friend is in her addictions and using manipulative techniques in her passive-aggressive rage to manipulate the situation or attempt to, and she's not going to have much success doing it, to be frank, because that's what her soul's needing to learn. She needs to learn that any time you attempt to manipulate a person using emotional techniques, it's not loving, and she needs to learn that. So, so highly unlikely. So she is in just as shut down or even more shut down place than Nikki herself is.
Mm. Which is very interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
It seems to me that the spectrum is not a spectrum of emotionality. It's about a spectrum of love and truth, and our emotions do grow as we progress along that spectrum.
Well, our emotions become real.
Yes.
See, this woman's emotions are all facade. So that's not real. None of that's real. And it's only when you start feeling the hurt child or where you've caused hurt to others, the two sides of things. The hurt child is all about forgiving others and feeling what you've done to others is all about repentance. Mm-hmm. And it's only when you start feeling those two groups of emotions that you actually make any soul-based progress. And once you do that, you will start seeing glimpses and eventually whole parts of your inner self, the self that God created, the real, true self that God created. But this woman is in her facade completely. She's completely shut down to all of her true self. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying this woman, the woman she's describing, that Nikki is describing, her friend, is shut down completely. Now, Nikki herself is shut down too. Mm-hmm. She's in denial, but she's not using as many emotionally manipulative techniques because she probably wasn't taught to do that in her childhood.
Yeah.
She's using denial as a tool and fear as a tool to shut herself down. And that's different techniques. So I would suggest, you know, again, we need to get out of the facade-based self and into what's really going on inside of the child in terms of what happened in the child's life, if we're ever going to make any true progression in our soul.
Yeah. Okay. I think that we've answered Nikki's question.
I think so. She says a lot of things down.
If you look in the third paragraph, perhaps.
Yeah, she says, being someone who lacks emotional expression and observing others who freely show their emotions, I just get confused. Well, the woman she's using an example, if that's an example of a person who's freely showing their emotions, and I can't agree, that's in a person who's freely demonstrating their facade and using emotionally manipulative techniques to control others. Now, that's not what I'm recommending to people.
No.
In fact, that's a long way away from what I'm recommending to people. So I wouldn't say, I feel that such a person who does those things lacks just as much emotional expression as someone who's completely in denial of their emotions or completely shut down like Nikki is. So I feel that they're equal, you know, like that there's not someone that's better than others. And this is why Nikki's getting confused.
Yeah.
She's getting confused because she's judging something by observation, looking at a person, but then she's seeing the person's life not changing. Now, what that indicates is that if a person's life isn't changing, then it means nothing is happening.
Yeah.
Nothing, no soul-based change is actually going on. Yeah. So let's be honest. What Nikki needs to do here is be honest about these people that she sees being emotional and go, has their life changed? No. If their life hasn't changed, then they're not expressing emotions from their true self or from their hurt self. They're only expressing emotions from their facade self, which is all about anger, rage, passive aggression, you know, using emotion as a manipulative tool to change other people and so forth. None of that will cause any change. And in fact, it will cause a darkening of your soul if you keep doing those kind of things.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I can understand why Nikki might be confused if she's thinking that that is the way to progress, because it certainly is not.
Yep.
And then she says, because even though they are emotional, it is still not it. Now, there's a feeling in her that she doesn't really trust at this point, that no, that can't be it. And the reason why this feeling exists is because she's going, oh, but her life's not changing, so something's wrong. And she's right, something is wrong. When a person's life is not changing, it means they're not actually doing the work. You know, it's quite obvious they're not doing the work and quite obvious their soul isn't changing. When your soul changes, your life changes. And in fact, your life will change quite rapidly. The instant your soul changes, usually within a few minutes, your life starts changing. That's how rapidly it occurs.
Mm-hmm.
And that applies to your body, your health, your life, your relationships, and everything about your life changes as soon as you actually address something causal. So if none of that is occurring, then it means no real changes are occurring. And the person who's doing all this so-called emotional processing is actually just having a tantrum and having manipulation, using emotion as a manipulative tool to remain in their facade self.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's what they're doing. So she says, is it because she is still resisting anger and childlike emotions? Yes, she is not only resisting anger, childlike emotions, she's also resisting the fact that she is not loving herself. She is being manipulative emotionally to others, which means she is not loving others,
mm-hmm.
and obviously has little desire to become more loving with others. So she's resisting quite a lot of things, actually. And she says, is it because she has demands and expectations? Yes. Demands and expectations all come from your addictions,
mm-hmm.
and this woman is in total addiction with her environment. That's why she remains in an abusive relationship, and she's in total addiction to remaining in that relationship because it gives her what she needs.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes what we need is to feel superior to another person. or feel better than somebody else. And something, and these are all things that she needs to analyze. This woman, Nikki's friend, needs to analyze if she's ever going to want to progress emotionally, right?
Yeah.
She is somehow addicted to that side of him. Yes, she is totally addicted to the man she ended up with, and that's why she stays with him.
Yeah.
She's totally addicted for a lot of reasons, and she needs to examine the reasons. Now, all of that means that she's in her addictions, and every time she cries, it's because her addictions are not getting met.
Yeah.
And that's anger.
Yeah.
That's not sadness. That's anger. That's an expression of rage, passive-aggressive, but rage nevertheless, to her environment, that somebody else needs to come and fix this man, or he needs to fix it in order for her life to improve.
Mm-hmm.
No, the only person you need to fix in order for your life to improve is you. And automatically once you do that, your life will improve.
Yeah.
And that means that the people who don't come along for the ride will leave your life, but they'll do it voluntarily because they want to. And the people who feel like, you know, want to join you in your progress will come into your life, and they'll do that voluntarily, not because you forced them and not because you have an addiction with them and not because you demanded something else of them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, you know, part of what being emotional looks like. Now, we've already answered her main question, I feel, but I feel it was an interesting question because...
It's a good question.
Because it demonstrates, I feel, what happens to a lot of people. A lot of people... look at emotion, they go, oh, that's feeling really off, you know, I don't, you know, and then they go, is that what AJ's talking about? Well, no, I'm not talking about that. Definitely not. I'm talking about something that's a sincere, honest process emotionally that's about connecting to either the hurt child that's in you or the person that the damage you've done to yourself through harming others.
Yeah.
And you need to connect to both if you're ever going to become at one with God. And eventually, once you do that, you'll release some real emotion and your life will instantly change.
Yeah.
And then you'll go, wow, this is what it feels like. It's actually quite good. It's actually quite good because I start to understand and have faith that if I really change my soul, then I've got the capacity to change everything in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And everything in my life will change once I change my soul. And once you understand those particular things from it and have faith in that, wow, you know, you can make some very good progress on the path because you've come to terms with some very basic truths about the path itself.
Yeah, yeah. But the process you're describing is sounds very personal.
Yes.
So it's not necessarily, we're not necessarily spewing our emotions out onto other people.
Yeah.
We're in introspective and reflecting and asking for God's truth on things, and we're experiencing emotions in that process.
Correct.
But it's not necessarily just whatever emotion we feel is releasing something.
No.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the emotions we feel come from unloving sources within us, and they are all about our demands and our addictions not being met. And as a result, they are unloving emotions. They are emotions that we perhaps still need to feel so that we recognise them and go, wow, I really feel like crying now that my husband spent all my money.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that?
Mm.
Why did I even give him the ability to spend all my money?
Yeah.
You know, you start to question those particular things, and that's important because you do need to question those things in order to become more loving of yourself and more loving of your husband under those circumstances. So yes, you need to question all those things, but it's going to be a very sincere, honest process. And not a process that is just like that never-ending crying about the same situation for years and years and years with no change occurring.
Mm-hmm.
That's a passive-aggressive rage, an attempt to manipulate the environment through your crying, and that's not very nice at all. And actually, it's actually going to cause a degradation of your own condition and therefore more pain for you and everyone around you in the longer term.
Yeah.
And that's not what we're talking about when we're talking about connecting with yourself emotionally.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.